thank you, Gerda, for joining us today, and I'm looking forward to learn a little bit more about your track, which is cognitive science. So
yes.
Can you tell me a little bit about the courses that are on offer in cognitive science?
Yes, of course. So the cognitive science track has three courses on offer. This is an introduction to cognitive science, which really introduces the students to the field. This is a course that is fully devoted to language and how language is processed in the brain. This is called psycholinguistics. Mm-hmm. And the third course is an advanced level course, which is called advanced cognitive science. And these courses are very much about how we as humans think.
Mm-hmm.
So they are about human cognition, our mental capacity, and we discuss topics such as perception, memory, language, but also consciousness, emotions, and so forth. Yeah.
Sounds great. So these are obviously the courses and what they're about, but
yeah.
What can students expect in terms of assignments that they might do?
Yeah. What the students can expect is this is a track in the science department, and
mm-hmm.
My background and also the background of the other instructor in the track, Dr. Antonidis, is really in neuroscience. So what they can expect is that we deal with cognition from a biological perspective mostly.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean that we don't talk about psychological theories and issues or linguistic topics or even philosophical topics. But the basis is really in biology and in science. And what they can really expect is that we will talk a lot about how our brain works and how our brain really deals with these different cognitive functions. Now, we have a wide variety of assignments, and they range from, of course, presentations. But for instance, in the 100 level course, we start off having students talk about a single research article so that they really can get acquainted with how to read the scientific literature. And this is really a skill that they need in the remainder of their career, and it doesn't really matter what kind of career you want to pursue. You need to be able to read this type of literature.
Mm-hmm.
And then they will do a critical analysis of that literature and really reflect on it. And of course, we practice this a lot in class too. Besides that, they get presentations, of course, and what they also do, we have a lot of homework assignments where it's not just recapping what they've been reading, but really telling me how that reading connects to anything that is of interest to them.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason I do that is that that will always create a piece of writing that will stick with the students, and that creates a wonderful starting point in the class for discussions. So that's basically what we do in the 100 level.
Right.
A lot. That's also what students say, oh, we do a lot here, but they also learn a lot. In psycholinguistics, actually, they do their own experiment.
Mm-hmm.
So they do a behavioral experiment studying language and how people actually perceive language, how they produce language. And they make a poster and present it to each other.
Mm-hmm.
Apart from that, they write a paper course, and there's exams, as in most courses. And then finally, in the 300 level, the students write a research proposal. So the level of the task that they have to do is going up, of
mm-hmm.
course. And we really try to introduce them to it step by step. And this is something that they do in a group, and they have to come up with an original research question. And this is also something that they present in the class. And usually we also go on field trips and all these kind of things.
Right.
Yeah.
It seems like you're building skills throughout the
yeah.
courses, really.
That's what we're trying to do.
That's
absolutely,
great.
Yeah.
And it also sounds as though students can really have their own input and take inputs from different courses. So what are some of the connections that you see? Like
yeah.
What are the students that come to the cognitive science track?
Yeah, there's many students that, for instance, are interested in biomed.
Mm-hmm.
They want to become a medical doctor or do biomedical research. And then, of course, learning about the brain is very important to them. And understanding human behavior is very important for a medical doctor.
Sure.
So those students tend to come to the courses. But also students that are, for instance, very interested in psychology. And what they like about the courses is that they've studied mind and behavior, and now they're going to study the biological machine that underlies it, the brain.
Mm-hmm.
So they see the different perspectives. From the humanities, I get students in, and I always love to have them because they bring so much to the discussion. that are interested, for instance, in linguistics, mm-hmm. and they're very much interested in this psycholinguistics course, but also students that are interested in philosophy, for instance, because this is also about the human mind and how we think,
mm-hmm.
but taking that from a very different perspective. And what it means in the class is that we have very lively discussions. But what it also means is that I will make students an expert in the field that they come from. And by doing that, they feel very welcome to talk about what they can bring to the class. And they teach in micro classes the other students, for instance. Mm-hmm. So this allows me to work with this diversity and to, you know, bring up the strength in every single student. So that is a type of assignment that we also do.
I imagine that that's great also for students to get all these different perspectives in and learn that way.
Yeah, absolutely, yes.
Then ultimately, of course, the question is what comes after? What's next for these students who have all these different perspectives?
Yes, well, first, of course, many of the students then do a senior research project in cognitive science, and examples of projects that Antonides and I supervise are, for instance, projects in virtual reality,
mm-hmm.
where students develop games, but also test these games in elderly people. And you could see this as some sort of mental fitness that we do. We try to train cognition of people with early stage dementia using VR. And then they work in an interdisciplinary team with computer science students that build the games, engineers perhaps, and also cognitive science and medical students, so to speak. That's one example of a project that they can do. But I guess what you mean by, and then after, you were referring to master programs. It very much depends. There is plenty of students that pursue really a master in cognitive science or cognitive neuroscience, and we are very successful in placing them there, I must say. Most students can actually go to the master of their choice, or, you know, maybe of their second or third choice, but it's hardly ever happening that is difficult. But also, some of these students combine neuroscience and cognitive science with math and computer science, and then they go into an AI, artificial intelligence master,
mm-hmm.
or a so-called computational neuroscience master. And yet others combine this with psychology and want to become a neuropsychologist. This is another type of master where you really deal with patients and their brain damage. And yet others combine this with biomed and go into a research master in the biomedical sciences. And then finally, if I can mention one more,
sure.
Students in the humanities tend to combine cognitive science and then maybe go into a linguistics or psycholinguistics or a philosophy of mind master. So they go in all kinds of directions, and this is the fun part of it, I think.
Yeah. The world is really their oyster.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Great. Well, thank you so much for sharing a little bit about your track and what the possibilities are within UCR.
Very welcome. Thank you for having me.
Sure.